Can you guess what this curious-looking device had to do with the Titan submersible? I have a high-detail model to answer this question and illustrate the finer intricacies of this flawed but remarkable craft, which imploded on its way to the Titanic wreck, claiming the lives of all five on board, including its creator. In the media coverage, carbon fiber was made out to be the boogeyman, when in reality, it is one of the strongest materials known to man. I will explain how I suspect it failed and reverse some of the myth around carbon composite, so you can come away from this video better able to make up your own mind. Titan made the big jump to five occupants while being significantly lighter and smaller than anything before. Previously, only two or three could dive at a time together to see the Titanic or do any deep diving. The pivoting front pressure dome was the door and made getting in and out much easier. Other submersibles involve awkwardly climbing down through a small hatch. The inside diameter was just 4 foot 4 inches or 1.3 meters and was lined with perforated plate. Everyone sat on the floor on a mat. This was the on button. The left screen displayed the sonar, and on the right was the maneuvering control display. Steering was done with the now infamous game controller. The rear panel closed off the aft pressure dome. On the door was a display from the camera feeds. Behind the door was equipment which had to be kept dry and at normal air pressure. We'll come back for a better look. Below the floor were four large oxygen cylinders, enough for 4 days, and in between them were batteries. Passengers could stow small items below the floor. The toilet doubled as the seat at the porthole behind a privacy curtain. It was basically a box to keep the plastic bottles and bags. Condensation formed on the inside surfaces that were cold from the freezing ocean and would slosh around at the bottom. It would pour out when the door was reopened. Bolts on the outside sealed in the crew. They could only be freed again with assistance from the outside. Subs have the nifty ability to hover in place. They do this by being at neutral buoyancy, where they neither sink nor float. On the landing skids were half-round lead weights for fine-tuning the neutral flotation. Before each dive, all crew were weighed with everything they were taking on board. By adding or removing weights, the support crew set the neutral buoyancy just right. Slung under the hull was the drop weight system. It controlled how Titan got down and back up again. It was a simple system using ordinary heavy steel pipes held in the drop weight frame. Titan descended unpowered down to the wreck. This was possible by carrying weights to sink. Once they reached the ocean floor, the two weights for the downward journey would be dropped and the sub would be at neutral flotation. The thrusters on the outside of the sub would maneuver it around to explore. The top thrusters were for up and down, the side ones for back and forward and turning. Once they were done exploring the wreck, more ballast pipes would be dropped and they would float back up to the surface. The weight drop system had multiple fail-safes. If those didn't work, the crew could roll the sub to one side and then to the other so the pipes fell out the sides of the frame. The sub would surface again by flotation from dropping weight. No power was needed for vertical travel. You might think the outside shell was where the water stopped and there was air on the other side. This is easily confused. But the outside coverings were there to enclose the equipment and improve streamlining. Without them, it becomes clear their purpose was more cosmetic. The water-to-air boundary was the pressure hull, the thick and extremely robust structure which resisted the crushing water pressure. The end domes were titanium, a light but very strong metal. It was the center tube that was made of carbon fiber. Slicing into the pressure vessel, we get to see inside the all-important air pocket. The crew compartment remained at normal atmospheric pressure during the dive. Everything outside was underwater in the ocean. Here again, you see how the oxygen and batteries fitted below the floor and everything had carefully allocated places. In the aft hemisphere was the essential equipment that could not be underwater and had to be at regular pressure. Oxygen was delivered to the passenger compartment via the regulator. The floating ball provided visual confirmation that the oxygen was flowing. The plastic box with a fan on top was the carbon dioxide scrubber. It contained soda-lime pellets which removed the excess CO2 exhaled by the humans aboard. They turned purple to indicate when they needed to be replaced after they were done absorbing carbon dioxide. As backup, there were lithium hydroxide cloths on board that could act as scrubbers. The passengers would have a safe, breathable air environment for as long as fresh oxygen flowed and the carbon dioxide was removed. The cabling needed to get outside without leaks. This was achieved with these hull glands, which had special connector plugs on each end. They were drilled through the titanium connector ring. The tail section was outside the main hull and wet. All this equipment was constructed to survive the pressure. The large batteries for propulsion and spotlights were here. Above them were twin control pods. Inside these strange orange covers were glass domes filled with oil. These devices were for stability control and navigation. At the back was buoyancy foam to balance the weight of the batteries and equipment. The salvaged tail assembly remained relatively intact despite the violence of the implosion. It was outside the crush zone, so was spared the main force. But the control spheres were missing and the fairings ripped off. The porthole was the largest one sent to such depth, so it could allow two people to look through at the same time. The water pressure cannot be overemphasized, and the force on just the porthole alone was an unbelievable 2,700 tons. Just imagine the weight of 450 elephants bearing down on this window. Acrylic is a favorite material for sub windows. This demonstration gives you some sense of how incredible the crush of the ocean was down at the Titanic. Why was this a carbon composite hybrid and not the traditional all-titanium pressure vessel? Using carbon shaved off about 7 tons of weight and enabled it to be much more compact. A titanium center tube would have added an extra 3.3 tons and needed another 3 tons of special syntactic foam to offset the steel weight and maintain neutral buoyancy. The extra size and weight would have made it much bulkier and less agile, requiring even bigger batteries and heavier frame, inevitably upping the weight of the other components too, ballooning the total weight to a hefty 17 tons. Instead, Titan could be a lean 10 tons, and a lighter sub meant a smaller support ship, which is the big expense. The hybrid solution offered major benefits and held the promise of redefining the possibilities of submersible technology. James Cameron made a blanket statement about carbon fiber being wrong for this application and not meant for the serious stuff.
You don't use composites for vessels that are seeing external pressure.
A conventional application would be like on an airplane, and the material is under tension, but in a submersible, it is under pressure, the exact opposite force.
Carbon fiber composites aren't really known for their compressive strength. They work best in tension.
And pretty soon it became accepted fact.
As we all know, carbon fiber is, again, very strong in tension, pulling it apart, but rather weak in compression.
This is just plainly wrong. Carbon fiber has exceptional compressive capability, exceeding that of most steels. However, tapping into this remarkable strength doesn't come easily and requires meticulous precision in the layup process. This composite Airbus wing withstands incredible compressive loads, not to mention how it carries the immense engine thrust forces to the fuselage. Titan went through two versions of carbon composite mid-body tube. OceanGate CEO Stockton Rush describes the evolution.
The carbon fiber, this is the mandrel, this thing is an inch and a half thick.
Filaments were laid down in alternating hoop and axial layers.
we'd wind a layer, and then we do a longitudinal pre-pregged carbon fiber lay on top and built it up to 5 inches thick.
I took it to 4,000 meters, and it made a lot of noise, which is a very sphincter-tightening experience.
Sub owner Carl Stanley was on the second dive.
Every 3 to 4 minutes, there was loud gunshot-like noises. That's a heck of a sound to hear when you're that far under the ocean.
And it wasn't getting quieter on the second dive. It should have been dramatically quieter doing it. So we scrapped it, we went back, we built another one. Sure, we went to aerospace quality. We use the same pre-preg that's used on the 787.
So what was wrong with the tubes? Carbon fiber had the necessary technical strength for this application. So I suspect weaknesses in the layup process. 3/4 of the water pressure acts onto the face of the tube. The hoop arrangement of fibers carries this massive compression force. They were more than capable of handling the load with a generous safety factor. There are few materials capable of these stresses. 1/4 of the force on the hull was from the pressure on the end domes squashing them together, and the axial fibers carried this load. This is likely where the problem lay. The geometry of the mandrel meant no tension was applied to these fibers, so kinks and wrinkles could not be pulled out. If the layup is bad, the load capacity is just a fraction of what it should be. I suspect the crooked longitudinal fibers progressively failed over the 13 or so deep dives. Or uneven axial layers form dangerous wobbles in the hoop filaments. The 5-inch structure loses all its strength if there was a defect lost in most of the thickness. The first hull had its axial fibers laid manually. In the second version, they rolled the fibers with the robot, which was better. But the mandrel was reused and the same problem of no axial tensioning was repeated. The winding was a lengthy process and took many weeks. Only a mandrel with rounded ends could have ensured the straight filaments throughout. But this would have required a new mandrel and meant throwing away both round ends, which would have accounted for approximately 40% of this really expensive material. The investigators have access to the wreckage, which holds crucial clues and will enable them to draw highly informed conclusions as to how the sub failed. Here we see a hull gland, which confirms this is the rear connector ring. Both rings were recovered. A long metal strip was dangling off the forward ring. This was a flange from the carbon fiber glue joint torn away in the implosion. Almost all flanges were torn off. This is the clearest evidence that it was the tube that failed and not the porthole or anything else. I find it really interesting that the outer flanges were blown outwards in the opposite direction of the implosion. Titan represented a radical departure from established submersible design norms, so it demanded a comprehensive exploration of this novel application of carbon fiber. The sphere was the tried and tested pressure vessel, so this new capsule shape had to be proven. The unusually thick layup needed to be fully scrutinized for all its implications. Plus, the integrity of the titanium glue joint under these extreme pressures had to be validated. Although it is important to add, the titanium and composite are regularly bonded in aviation, so the idea is not new. Only by testing to destruction could they establish what the real-world failure pressure was and understand the long-term fatigue performance. This was the only way to build in enough safety margin to make it capable of the repeated dives that were expected from it. Hull 2 was tested once in a pressure chamber and then sent diving without knowing its failure depth.
Tested it at the Deep Ocean Test Facility in Annapolis, Maryland, an amazing facility, the only one on the planet where you can put something like that in for a test. And then in 2021, after having to cancel twice before, we were able to go out and dive on the Titanic.
Stockton Rush foolishly thought he could circumvent a destructive testing program by relying on his unproven acoustic sensors to detect the early signs of failure. But the brittle nature of composite gives little to zero warning, and it is safe to assume the system didn't work. It is unbelievable how he had such confidence to dive himself and to take others with him. Carbon fiber fails suddenly, like glass, without warning. Together one moment, and in 1,000 pieces the next. Titan failed because OceanGate did not have the resources and commitment to perform the rigorous and exhaustive testing to thoroughly research and develop this novel use case. And considering OceanGate's cavalier attitude to best practices, I'm not convinced they could have successfully pulled off making an all-titanium craft either. I find it tragic that Stockton Rush focused his boundless energy in producing a craft with a slightly wider affordability, instead of making peace with the astronomical passenger fee, which was the only path to generating the funds to justify the huge research and development costs that were essential for guaranteeing success. Composite, if properly researched and built correctly, was strong enough for this application and would have opened the path to lighter and much more compact and nimble submersibles. Another cruel myth is the fake transcript, which fed the terrifying notion that the crew knew they were in peril for 19 minutes. Many clues prove this is nonsense, such as descending with the thrusters, which is not the way it worked. And in an emergency, you take immediate action. You don't waste precious seconds typing out your intentions first. It is for the investigators to determine for certain what happened and why it failed, and I look forward to their findings. I value the credibility of my channel, and so accuracy is important. Corrections are welcomed, and so is any inside information. I hope you found this useful, and if you did, be sure to like and subscribe. Thank you for watching till the end, and I will see you next time.